Hello, everybody. So now I'm starting with the first presentation today. I think you already saw my model in the agenda from Andreas, but I want to mention a few words about what I want to show you in the next 1.5 hour. Especially, I want to model with you a tennis court for two places. The tennis court I selected only because we want to define it. We want to define a roof about a special place with special dimensions, but I lose some words afterwards. Then afterwards, after we have defined the model, we bring up basic loads, let's say surf weight, snow load, wind loads. For wind loads, we will have to think about because the wind can blow below the roof and above the roof and can produce some turbulences around. And here I want to show you our new product, R-Wind simulation, where I can create wind loads for this type of model. Afterwards, we go back to RFM and take care about stability design and member design and membrane design itself. So you will see a complete workflow for this model in our programs. And this gives now the point to change into the program. I move now to RFM. Here and open a new sheet. So open here new sheet. Maybe we call it ITT and select here a 3D model with a upwards directed Z-axis and use a template. Let's say here information day 2020. It's only to have predefined materials. So, yes, we overwrite it. And now we have our 3D environment to model this tennis court. And I would say, as for every model, we start in a 2D plane. And here I want to define the wall plane. So let's start in CX plane, where we have to define the special dimensions of a tennis court. And let's say the roof should arch here in this direction. So the longitudinal direction of this tennis court is the X-axis. And we know from some rules that this tennis court needs a length of, let's say, about 24 meters plus some safety space behind and before. So we need at least a space of 18 meters. And to define this or to develop a special geometric according some dimensions, I want to show you today our guidelines as idea how to perform such a situation. Here you will find guidelines and you will see it's not a member, it's more a dashed line, which have, let's say, an infinite length, but will be displayed only in this grid plane, grid point plane. And here we place one at, let's say, 0 meters, so at the bottom, where we say, okay, this is the bottom elevation of our tennis court. Then we place one at 4 meters. This is maybe the starting point of the roof, and one on the top, let's say at 9 meters, where this is the space what the tennis players needs for their sports. And then I add one additional guideline, which is at 10 meters, only to, let's say, I call it safety elevation, or because I want to hold up my roof above this line to be sure that the tennis player have their 9 meters. Then we define with the guidelines also the longitudinal direction of the tennis court, and here I define At first, the tennis plays itself. It's by minus 11.89 and 9 on the right side, plus safety space minus 18.29 and 18.29 on right side. So this, let's say, dashed lines defines now everything about our roof. Let's say roof is starting here on this point. This rectangle is, let's say, the space what the players need for with full elevation. And now we span a roof above. And here is my principal idea to use an ellipsoid shaped roof. For this special shape, I use here our special line, ellipse line, where I can define an ellipse here from starting point of roof to another side. And now I can scale up the ellipse to reach the shape of the roof. Here we have our 9 meters. I use 1 meter more. And this curve shows now the expected shape of the roof. Of course, we don't need one on the bottom. So I divide this line by 3 nodes and delete everything what is not needed. So this part here and also this part here. Now we have everything. So the grid points could be deactivated. Now, one we need, moment. Here we need, let's say, one in the middle only for later action. Now we can remove these grid points. And you see, this is our tennis courts. Here the sports players play their games. Here is the safety distance and the roof spans. This is only a half of the roof spans above this place or region. In the next instance, we take the shape of this ellipsoid function to create a truss girder. And the truss girder is divided into two straight segments, what running from, let's say, top point to midpoint and to bottom point. To find this midpoint here, I divide this line again here, let's say, with one division node. And I get here the midpoint of this arc. And now I can place between the top point and the midpoint a line and again to the bottom point and can delete again the unneeded element. So these two straight lines is now the half of the truss girder above the tennis court, and we see the top ordinate of the upper chord is above this 9 meter. Therefore, I used this 1 meter more for defining the curve. So with these two lines, we defined, let's say, completely the geometry of the roof, what you will see in the next instance. At first, we define the height of the truss girder for the roof, and this is 1.5 meter. So I need a parallel line to this, which is going down here 1.5 meter. To get this, let's click on this line and use here set parallel line. And now pick directly the second, and you will see in the preview the parallel line here with a distance of 1 meter. We define here 1.5 meter and we define here it should go downwards. So the preview is fine, then I apply it. The only thing what I have to change is that I shorten this line to be directly on the mid axis. So in the next step, I have to define between the upper and the lower chord of the truss girder, let's say, all diagonal members. These diagonal members, I know it's always a not so easy game to define this because it's hard to find all points, but I do it always in this way, and maybe this helps you also. I define at first on the bottom chord, here division points, divide by 3 points. And now I need for a zigzag diagonal distribution here division points in the mid of these 2 points on the upper chart. And to get this, I define here a temporality line from the mid to the perpendicular on the upper chart. And the same I do here for the top part. Yep. And now I can delete what is not needed. Here is this and this. And now I can start copying the connection points for the diagonals only by drag and dropping the nodes. Here for the lower part and the same for the upper part. I take the distance and now I go into left direction with this same distance. And so you can quickly create these connection points for the diagonal with the right distances. And this offers us now to define all these lines here in a zigzag distribution to all points. So again, here, here, here again, and you see we reach here with these few division functions, or by using these division functions on a quick way, the geometry of this ellipsoid shaped truss girder or half truss girder. So now let's say generally the geometry is here defined now. It's our only lines. We haven't defined any members now on it, but I want to prepare this geometry for all effects or situations we have to design afterwards. This is also when we want to design such a structure, we have to take care about buckling, and I suppose that the upper chord or the truss girder will buckle out of plane. So I want to prepare it for it. And I suppose that the length here from here to here, let's measure it to see how long it is. Let's say about 10 meters is too long and it will buckle in the middle side. So I plan to support this truss girder also in the mid of the straight lines. And for this, I create directly some, let's say, division points and also lines for members. So here for the lower part in the mid and a second for the upper part. So this gives me the option now that I can define here a bracing and here also that the geometry contains already the bracing points for the truss girder. So in the next instance, we only have to bring down the loads of the truss girder to the bottom, so to this point. And here we have following situation. We know from this specific point, we know that the truss roof is running 1.5 meter downwards in the same inclination. So I take this line with the control copy command, go on this line, and extend it to 1.5 meter. This is, let's say, pretty easy. We can say extend to line 1.5 on the end. And okay, now it have 1.5 meter, yes. And we can define the missing member lines which running here from the bottom to these points. And now we have a connection for the truss girder to the bottom. And this line geometry represents now a half of our structure truss girder, and we can start now applying members on it. For applying members, I cut everything that we have single members, yes. And we can start with the members for the top chord. If you want to select the top chord, you will suffer the issue that you can't draw a rectangle on the, on this line, and you will always select some more members. Here I recommend always this rhomboid selection window where you can draw such rhomboid windows to select only what you want. And now is only the upper chord line red, and we can go into the properties, edit, and can define here below the member sheet a cross section. We take here a beam cross section, and for the cross section itself, we take here a circular hollow tube with the dimensions of, let's say, almost 200 millimeters with a thickness of 8, so with steel 355. So then we can confirm this setting, and you see, we'll see that this line is going blue. It's not going blue, then the program is drawing the cross section into the graphics. So in next step, we can let's say select the rest and assign the rest of the member. It's a smaller circular hollow tube. The task is now only to select only the lines below. And this is also difficult to select the lines below, even not to match or to touch the upper chord. Therefore, here maybe also a trick what is quite helpful in some situations. I use always this cross section sheet here. Set my focus on the existing cross section, what is the upper chord. Go to edit and select here related object, what means also the lines behind and the notes. And go here to the visibilities and say, please hide the selection. So now the selection is hided, and we can draw a complete window above the rest. What is the lower part? Go to the properties, line, edit, and open here again the member sheet and assign here a new circular hollow tube, what is in this case almost 14 centimeters, diameter is almost 14 centimeters. For this we use maybe, this here is a thickness of 6 millimeters, yes. Yeah. Then all cross sections are defined for this half truss girder plus support construction. And as mentioned before, we prepared this situation, this system already for bracing out of plane, so on these points. And when we think one step more, it will be a 3D structure, as you saw on the pictures before. And I assume that I want to calculate the geometrical imperfect. This means I have to define between these braced points, let's say, a precamber shape. And to do this, I have to give the program the information that these member selections are one segment. And to do this, I use member sets. And member sets could be defined for these segments, and it would be nice to do it now at this point before we mirror it and copy it, because now I have to do this only for a few member sets and not for all, and this saves time. And therefore I select now here the first segment, the lower segment, then I jump over the next and select here the third and go into the properties of the selected members, and here the program offers me create set of members. He realizes that these four selected member groups are independent groups, therefore I get four member sets, and after confirmation the program draws a dashed line around this group. Maybe by watching the wireframe model, you will see here he draw a frame around this group. And now we do the same for the missing one. So here again for this part, for this part, for this part, and finally for this part. And now we can go into the properties, members, create set of members. Again, he realizes four pieces. And now we have defined here the segments for applying finally imperfection loads for defining a pre-camber situation between braced points. If we think now again one step forward, we know if we define here a pre-camber situation, let's say a S curve around this truss girder, we have to take care that this selections running in same or opposite directions. For this, I recommend now at this point to display the direction of the member sets, and you will see the upper chord is running downwards, the lower chord also. So our task is now to reach finally a S curve as imperfection situation to mix it. And therefore I select the lower part and the second part, right click and reverse orientation. This is running now upwards, then downwards, upwards, downwards. And this helps me finally to apply in one step this geometrical or this imperfection load without modification of sign by using these different orientations of member sets. Now, with defined with this situation, we can start mirroring. And the mirroring is pretty easy. With one hand, I select these members here and go here to mirror option. So of course we want to create a copy. We want to mirror on the blind CY. So CY is correct. Center is also okay. But to hold these defined orientations of set of members, I say here, please don't adjust lines and members rotation or directions. And with confirming this situation, you will see that this member setup will have the orientation what we expect. So upwards, downwards, then or then here again downwards, upwards, but they are changing the direction over the length of the arc. So now we have one frame. It seems as it is ready for copying out of plane, but by checking the model I realized that the appeared bending moment around these corners here is too big, so we need here a bigger or a bigger height of the truss girder. So I round these corners by defining here a line, the same here on this corner and again on this corner. The guidelines are not needed now, we can remove it. Oops. And now we draw this corner point here to the middle of to the middle of line here, the same here, and the same here. Now is everything done and this system is ready for copying out of plane, so into the y-axis. For this topic, I select everything, of course, and go to the copy function, say I need one copy. Of course, I have two tennis courts to cover, but I prepare at first the model for one, and then I copy it again for the second. And the distance is we need at least for this for the sport itself, let's say 15 meters. So I need one safety distance I add a safety distance. So I copied now 16 meters in y direction. And of course I activate again these adjustments because now everything is fine when I adjust it. And I confirm this, and I have here now two of these, let's say, Drasgoeder frames. Of course, if you see it now as structural engineers, they are not supported, they are not connected to each other, so they are not stable in system. And our task is now to connect it to each other, that they build one structure which can carries the loads down to the bottom. And for this, I define between these two frames connection members. Of course, the distance is big, 60 meters, so I need a specific cross section for it. I selected here HGB 300, which is connected hinge to the frames. So I take here a beam, go here into the library, and select here a rolled cross section and go here to the HGBs 300 and okay. And I want to connect it hinged, so I define on start and end a hinge definition around V minor and major axis here on start and end, of course. And now I can define this connection member between the corner nodes, let's say, and bracing nodes. I think it's easier only to copy it. So I drag it only to the points here, and I do it only for one half because I can mirror it afterwards after definition of all settings. At the moment it seems good, but if we display the cross sections, it looks not so nice. So here I recommend always below the display navigator, below members, for cross section outlines, you will see the assigned cross section in the orientation of the beam. And if we watch in y direction, you will see this HGB is orientated to the global coordinate system, what is not expected. I want to rotate this member always to this stability plane. So I go into the properties and say, please rotate the, let's say, the plane of the web, so the XC plane of the member itself, so long until you meet this point of this plane here. Okay, and you will see it will orientate to this plane. Huh? The same for the others. So properties open, you can open the properties by double clicking on the members. Help node XC, and the help node is this node here. Yeah, again for the next XC, and we select this node. This is here XC, and again, and the last one help node XC, and the top node. So now all members are oriented. We can check it. You see it will be defined in this plane, so all have changed its rotation according to this setting. Now, if we consider the hinge here between the left and right side, the member will only couple forces but will not create any stability inside this structure. So I want to brace it here, and for this I want to define a brace member from this top node to, let's say, a node of this member. And for getting this, I want to show you following method. I select the properties of the members, go here to create node on line with distance. I select here, for example, 1.5 meters, the mean height of the truss girder, and confirm this setting. With this action, create node on line, you get a node what is not red like the others and gray, and this node is have special properties. It don't divide the member. The member remains as one piece, and the node is not defined by global coordinates, then by a start and end distance of the member itself. So if I move the member, the node will also move. We create the same node on the right side, or better for all. So at first here, member create node online distance with 1.5. Okay, and the same for the others. So member create node online distance 1.5. The question why I do now, or why I use now this node online, please take care always that you have to do a design for this member, that you have to apply imperfections, that you have to apply loads and so on. And if this member remains as one part, you have only to assign one element. The same similar thing we did for this, let's say, member selections for the imperfections. We said afterwards, okay, these divided members are one segment, but it makes extra work. And here is another solution by using this node on lines, by holding this element as one element, but define nodes on this element for connecting something. So what we want to connect, let's say here a truss girder with a circular hollow tube of 100 millimeter diameter. So I go here to members, go here to truss members, where we are, truss, and select here a cross section from library. It's a tube with 100 millimeter diameter and a thickness of 3 millimeters. So let's take care if we find it here, 100 with 3.2 millimeters. Yes, and okay. And now we can define it here from the AGB to the top chord of the beam. The same for all other situations. Okay, again for here. And the last one here. Now we can start mirroring these members on the another side. For this, maybe always click only in the cross section table to the relevant cross section. You will see they will be highlighted, they will be selected, and we can mirror it, create copy on the XC plane, and the mirror point is maybe the center point of this node, and okay, and we get these members on the another side. So as next, to finalize this model, we have also to introduce a global bracing, that the full structure will not move into the y direction. For this, I add here a truss member from bottom point to to this brace point, and here I use truss member type and this 14 centimeter circular hollow section, and connect here the points from here to here. So now the model itself looks already finished, but it isn't, because it's only a member structure. So if the snow is falling or it's raining, it can rain through the structure. So we have to also to apply a membrane sheet, and we also have to take care that this model is braced in the planes of roof, so here and here. So maybe finalize this bracing and then change to the membranes. For these bracings, I recommend to add tension members. I open again the members, go here to tension members and select here maybe a road cross section with 20 millimeter solid section, and combine or connect the points with crosses here. So from here to here and from here to here. Then I take this structure and copy it one cell above and move only the nodes to the corners. The same here. Then we copy it again and we move it again to the corners. And then the last one for this half of truss girder. Now and again here. Yes. So now the bracing is done for this half, and now we can start adding a membrane sheet above, and the membrane sheet will be connected to this line here. Then it will also run to this line and to the top point for this quarter. So between, I draw it here, the membrane is running here from the top chord to this lower part of the structure, but is connecting to this line. And this line is not, it's only a line, it have no stability or no resistance. So in fact, it have to be at least a cable to transport the forces of the membrane back to the right and left girder. So I change it to a cable beam. And here we use a cable member type and select here a member, a cable member. For example, here from our cable library, I use here manufacturer, for example, this one, and use here this 45 cable with a cable material. Yeah, and done. Then we have also defined here the cable, and now we can start implementing or defining the membrane itself between the two frames. To do this, we need, of course, a surface definition and a material. From material definition, it's hard or not easy because we have no membranes inside our library, because the values are not ruled by some standard. So it's always tested for every project itself. So I want to show you only how it's done in standard case. So I open a new material setting. Oh, not cross section, materials, of course. Open a new material section. Maybe we can define color. Let's display it as green, for example. Then we give a name, maybe membrane. And here we can define the stiffness, what we get as structural engineers from the testing institutes. As you can see here, this is an isotropic material where we can only define one Young's modulus. But generally, these membranes or one part of it have autotropy, so it means it have a higher stiffness in one direction than in the another one. And to simulate this in the program, you have to change here to the model autotropic elastic 2D. And this offers us now the different Young's modulus in different directions, so in typical warp and weft direction. And we can define here the values of the institute. By watching the unit behind, you will see here is written maybe force per surface, and the institutes generally write force per line. This comes because they reduce the thickness of the relatively thin membranes into the number itself. Our program don't know that it's a membrane. It only thinks it's a material and expects the general Young's modulus unit. Therefore, we have to change the figures and according a reference thickness. Let's take, for example, 1 millimeter. So I know I have a stiffness of 1000 kilonewton per meter and reference it to a thickness of 1 millimeter. So I add 3 zeros and now the unit don't fit. So I write only kilonewton per square meter. And after changing the cell, the program is changing the unit to the input unit. In the another direction, I expect 800, so I write 80. In the shear stiffness direction, so in YC and XC, I have no stiffness because it's a membrane. I define a pretty small value. Zero is not allowed because then the program thinks it's an input error. And for the shear of the membrane itself, I take here maybe according sensibility study a value of 30. And for Poisson ratio, we take here, for example, 0.2. Now the stiffness is defined and we can fill in the missing gaps for surf weight according a 1 millimeter reference thickness. I write here 10 kilonewton per cubic meter. Thermal expansion I let with zero because we don't add some temperature load, and the partial safety factor I set to 1. Now I can confirm this setting and I have now a membrane material available for defining a membrane surface. And for defining a membrane surface, we do now following. We hide the members and go into the surface elements. Here select boundary lines, define now here the material membrane, and for stiffness type membrane autotropic, what means it's a element what can only transport membrane tension but no compression and no bending. And for reference thickness, we define now here in constant thickness 1 millimeter. And by using this 1 millimeter, you can see in the stiffness matrix check that we have now here in X direction our 1000 and in Y direction our 800. The value is not exactly 1800 because we added here a Poisson ratio of 0.2, I think. Yeah. So now we can confirm with this setting. Okay, and can add this membrane sheets here inside this flat plane segments. One is done, it will be visualized by this dashed line around, and now the second. And the second is done. So by displaying the colors or the rendered style, you will see now that the membrane is now visualized with green and it's hanged in to the upper chart, and we can go ahead with mirroring. The mirroring demands now that we bring the stuff on the left side to the right side. So I watch into the X direction and select all this inside stuff and say, please mirror, create copy. A mirror plane is CY, and the mirror point is maybe here, this top point. Yes. And okay, and we get the stuff on the other side. So now we can create the second tennis court on the left side. For this, I watch into the X direction, but I hide the bracing members, these crosses here. And therefore I go to the cross section round 20, say here, edit, select, related objects, and say please hide these selected objects, And now I can select all this stuff here without this glosses and mirror it on the left side by using CX plane. CX plane, mirror point is now here on this axis. And okay. And now we have the second tennis court without this bracing system inside, but all other members are here. We see also here the membrane. And now it looks quite good and we can start defining the boundary condition. Boundary condition type one, the support is quite easy. We define only which nodes should not move. So here I define on the legs, maybe a hinged support. On the roof, the loads, for example. But before, when I watch this model and take a closer look, I will see, is this the right model I want to calculate? The roof is quite flat. Also, this cable is straight. Could this be in reality? Because I assume when I apply a membrane, it's curved, and even the cable is curved. And in initial or permanent situation, we have also pre-stressing, and how big is the pre-stressing? So this brings me up that I have to do before the main structural analysis a form finding task to find the place of the, let's say, green elements in the space which is corresponding to any pretension. And for this, I have to activate now, let's say, the form finding process. And the form finding process is hidden because not everybody needs it for every type of calculation. So in the general data, you can activate it here. And with activation of this check, we get here globally a form finding task, and some properties get, or the elements itself get some form finding properties. And the form finding properties, let's say for the cables, so let's display cables. Go here to wireframe and go to fuse and say, please show me all members with the type cable, the green ones. We can define, for example, some condition to find a pretension shape. And here we have the option, for example, edit. Here we have now options, what was not active before, but with activation of form finding, we have now some sub properties, which gives the shape of the cable. And we can define now, please define or give us a shape where the cable have a target length, a relative target length related to the initial input, a specific sag, a relative sag, or a specific force. So in my case, I say I want to have a shape where the member or the cable member holding 15 kilonewton, for example. And if the membrane is tensioned on it, the cable or the geometric is moving so long until we get 15 kilonewton in it. The same is now for the membranes. So I say here now, please display me the surfaces by material membrane. And here we say these surfaces, edit, have also such settings, a form finding setting, where we can say these surfaces holding some tension with 1 kilonewton in X direction and 1 kilonewton in Y direction. And the program or the form finding task should find the place of all these mesh nodes of these surfaces until it can hold in every point this predefined definition in combination, of course, with the cable members on the borders. So quite cryptic at first, but when we say now this sharp-edged shape is not valid because it cannot transport any any homogene pretension. It will get some wrinkles. But how the model should look like to transport a specific pretension without getting wrinkles? Then we can start now here this form finding process. And this is not a regular statistical analysis, and it's more finding the shape of mesh nodes by transporting the predefined pretension to the supporting construction itself. So he's thinking. And preparing some data for the visualization. Yep. And now you see in background already. Let's hope that this window will be removed. Yep. Maybe without this, without results. You see now, after form finding process, you get a curved shape. So the cables are get a sag, and even the membranes are not flat or straight between the supporting members, and they get also a sag inside in this direction and even in the another direction. This form finding gives us now a new, let's say a new geometry with memorized loads and forces. So let's take a look on our, let's say, members type cable. And if we watch here the results, for example, the normal axis force, we have now here inside the expected 15 kilonewtons, what was our input. So the program searched the shape of the cable by transporting the force of the membrane to hold 15 kilonewtons. The same for, let's say, for the membranes, if we watch here the membrane forces here Nx, you will see the membranes holding in every mesh node, oh, moment, 1 kilonewton in X and 1 kilonewton in Y direction. Of course, all other members like the truss girder transports now these forces down to Earth, but it's a internal load what produces no sum of forces in X, Y, Z. So it's like a pretension. And now we have a model which contains or holding these internal forces what are now a property of the model itself, and we can. And every type of calculation we start now are done on this already loaded model with these moved finite elements for the cables and membranes. And this is now also the point to start applying loads for the regular structural calculation. The start of such calculation is maybe here to apply a load case. Maybe the first is surf weight, where we add surf weight in Z direction. Then we apply, for example, a snow load, where we can say here, okay, we have a surface load, and according standard, the load is projected and is minus 0.52, for example. We add this load to the membranes. You will see it's projected. And now we also have to define the wind loads. The wind loads are not so easy because the wind can blow here below and above. And even here in this direction through Sitrasgörde, it have not a flat roof. So I would say it's pretty hard to find a standard rule which gives us values for loading this to give equivalent wind loads for this type of model. And this, let's say, basic difficulty was our challenge to create a program for civil engineers to create a load skin for such type of models. And we created for this a program called our wind simulation, which defines us or creates us now following load cases with wind loads. And this is working like this. You go here now, you have this model in your RFM model, and you open here below calculate I call it interface, the RWIND simulation interface, where you can predefine the wind loads. Yeah, how the wind load situation itself for which you want to calculate forces. So you have to calculate here, or you have to define here the wind directions. So we know our model is symmetrical globally, so it's sufficient to work with two load cases. For example, here, generally I can define a wind direction for every 10, with an increment of 10 degrees, and then you get maybe a wind direction for 0, 10, 20, 30, and so on. In our simple case, I would say 90 degree incremental step is enough, but in this case, it's sufficient to work only with 0 and 90 degrees. Then you can define the wind speed for which you want to calculate forces. Imagine we doing this by placing this model in background in a numerical wind tunnel where we define in the entrance of the wind tunnel the wind situation what we want. To make it comfortable, we defined here, or we made a tool which gives you the wind speeds at according to the different standards. For example, Eurocode, I use, for example, German Annex, where you can say I have here a wind load in wind zone 1 for Terra category 2. Then the program creates for this a wind speed diagram over the high, and even a turbulence diagram. And to create, let's say, wind loads on the model according to this normative wind speed diagram I define on the entrance of the wind tunnel this mean wind speed according wind zone 1 by considering this Terra category 2 and the turbulence diagram according Terra category 2. And these settings resides finally in two load cases, in wind load case 3 and wind load case 4 for 0 and 90 degrees. Of course, you have some settings in behind about kinematic viscosity of wind itself, about meshing, about how you want to get back forces on members, should T-hold results. Many features are hidden in these settings top, but our basic wish is now here, or preparation is to calculate now here these two load cases 3 and 4, or create loads for these two load cases. And I would press now calculate everything in background. This would take, I would say, 20 minutes to get loads. I don't want to use now this important time for waiting on these results. Therefore, I prepared it. I close this window and open a prepared model with the same results here. Yep. Now this model contains already results. It contains also this 0 and 90 degrees, but let's go back where we changed. So wind simulation, And go to these load cases, and you see now these two load cases are checked, so we have results for it. But let's take a look inside what was done. And we open this scheme here, load case 3, in this wind tunnel program or wind simulation. And this program was used in background to calculate all these forces. And to imagine also this numerical wind tunnel, let's take a look here. And you will see the model, like you see it here in the picture. Now we placed in this wind tunnel. So this was the entrance of the wind tunnel. So the gray region is the terrain, and here is the model acting in the wind tunnel. And for this model, we calculated the wind flow around. This means we calculated around the velocity of the air or medium around the model. You will see here we have the velocity of the wind speed diagram over the high, then the model interacts. Here we get a lower speed, here we get a higher speed, then even to this speed we get a pressure around the model. You will see here in front of such a sharp edges we get an increased pressure, here we get a negative pressure, and all these results plus maybe also the direction of the medium in the space, by knowing this on every point in space, not only in this plane then also besides the model, we can evaluate the pressure on the model itself. So here I can create a stress plot according to the pressure around the model on the model. So here you get finally from the air, the resulting forces from the air around the model on the model, and you will see we have here our pressure in front of the sharp edge. Here we have our suction. Even on bottom, it's different. Yeah. So here it's increased, but it acts on both sides different. So we get also here a suction force because according to the interaction of the model, we get here a suction. And all these values, by knowing this, we can produce loads. Maybe even here you can see how loads of the wind flow acting on members. So the first members get the biggest part, all other members get not so much, but even some suction sideways. And all these forces we can get back to RFM and using for calculation. Maybe to visualize how the wind is acting globally on the model, we can also use this maybe 3D results in space and create these streamlines to have a idea how the wind is flowing around the model, maybe from top view in Z direction. Maybe we can animate it also. You will see how the wind is blowing around and producing here some inclined wind stream lines. The same for inside where we get such a small rotating vortex inside. And you will see even here the effects that the wind is flowing quite fast on the top and in the bottom not so fast. So but these streamlines are only a result of all this what we calculated around the model, and finally this is the expected results what we want for RFM, this surface quantity, surface pressure on the model, and we can define this even as CP coefficient based on the top speed without any disturbing effect. So this was maybe everything what is behind this calculation, what took this 20 minutes. And now if I close the window, we have these load cases now with all effects in RFM. And we have now here to our surf weight and snow load case, even the wind load case. And you see now it's already calculated. Here the wind loads are pressing down the membrane inside the model, and here it's a, it, we have a suction effect. What is lifting the membrane? And this is maybe already the result with it's a deflection result, but even with some forces, what are produced inside the membranes. And you can visualize also the loads from our wind itself here with the result distribution of load, wind load using our wind simulation. And if we display this, you will see this is the load what is transported from the wind tunnel analysis to our firm for further statical structural analysis. And now we have wind loads and we can start, let's say, designing the model. And for the design itself, we take now these four basic load cases and create a combination. The combination could be done by according any standard, for example, Eurocode 0. I use here German annex, but we have many more. And with confirmation, we get now a different environment where I can give the program the command to create from these four load cases actions. This means we have one permanent action, one snow action, one wind action with these two load cases with combination expressions. What means here the red one where we have these increased forces according gamma values. The green are for serviceability. This I remove now for these presentations to have a better view what we are doing. And the program is creating from all actions action groups. So he combines it with these gamma factors and creates finally load combinations. What means he creates one with surf weight increased, so with surf weight and snow increased, surf weight snow wind 0, wind 90, only wind 0, only wind 90. So here again with snow and wind, but here is wind leading. So all combinations what are possible, the program will generate it, and you have it here available in CO1 to CO8. In the next step, we have to think about how the model is designed. We know we have membranes inside. We know these membranes induce a geometrical nonlinear calculation. So this is already here that the CO1 to CO8 will give us forces on deformed geometry. But we don't know how critical it is, how critical the model reacts against negative compression forces. So we can make a small intermediate analysis with the module RF stability, where we say, please calculate, for example, 50 eigenshapes, buckling shapes for the vertical load case, what means surf weight plus snow load. And let's run this analysis. And this analysis gives us now buckling shapes, what means, and a buckling factor. What means this factor means if I increase the load case with this factor, the model will be destroyed according to this shape, simplified said. And if we get factors bigger than 10, we know it's not critical for our analysis. It's also maybe what is ruled in the standard that I should only consider critical shapes which increases my internal forces or results more than 10%. But more will be visible with this list here. So he's thinking. Yeah, and gradient. We get a list with 50 lines or rows. And here you get a critical load factor. So if I multiply my load of CO2, what I defined before, the results will be increased with this factor here, pretty critical at first. And you will see for, let's say here, a factor of 10, the increasing factor is going smaller than 10%. So our interesting field of the shapes is running here until, let's say, 36. And this says nothing at the moment, this list, but we have to match it with the buckling shape itself. So I jump into the graphics and let's start from the most critical one. And you will see, okay, the model is pretty weak in y direction, yeah, because we have a small bracing. This means, okay, the model will globally be destroyed into y direction. And if we watch all shapes, you will see there is a lot of, here is our typical S, not S shape, but between these bracing points. We have many, many shapes which will destroy the model in y direction. Here is one in another direction, but it's only one member. So here we have something else again in y direction. Here is one special, again one member here, member. Here is again y direction. I don't see where it's buckling. Oh, here, so this AGB beam. Yeah. But globally, no buckling in X direction. What is comes out from this type of analysis? So I would say, generally, our effect is, so here the first is starting, maybe, but it's also y direction, yeah. So until 36, we have almost all shapes in y direction, which shows that the model is pretty weak in y direction, but gives me also information that I apply for this type of calculation imperfection into y direction. And for this, I create a new load case. Imperfection. Then I deactivate only our predefined set of members. Where we are, set of members, yes. And we go into the imperfection setting and say, please simulate us the set of members with a pre-camber of, let's say, according to the cross section we need here, relatively defined in y direction. Yeah, and now I can draw a window with this setting above all, and you see from when we take a top view that the program creates here such a typical S curve according our defined member sets between the bracing points. And again, we need the imperfection for the columns. So let's define or let's visualize the columns. The columns are here. Display only these columns, yes. And here we take again a new imperfection in y direction on members. Now no precambers and an inclination of with the standard value of 200 and applied on this member. And say running, so all in direction of this wind load. Now we applied the imperfections quite quickly, but they should represent only a global imperfection of the model. And if I assume this, or let's say the governing imperfection, then it means for me, I have to do the member design. This is global imperfections on geometrical, or with considering geometrical nonlinear calculation. It demands that I have to do all checks for members. So means cross section check, stability check, lateral torsional buckling check, but with the buckling length is member length. So if we know we applied global imperfections, we can do the buckling checks with member length. So for this, I give our design program all members to design, all members without cable, because cables have only a limit value design. We can design it according German annex, and we can now specify everything what is needed for design. Material is clear, cross sections also clear, intermediate restraints are not here, and effective lengths I let on value 1 because I assume a geometrical nonlinear calculation with global imperfections in the governing weak directions, what we checked with our stability analysis. Lateral torsional buckling is for these circular hollow tubes not interesting because they are closed cross section, but for here, for these HEB beams, we have settings here. Yeah. So then we run this calculation and expect a design. So he have to do at first the calculation of the load combinations because we never calculated this result. So this is now needed to calculate these 8 combinations, I think. You see here the convergence diagram reacts like a stairway, and this is connected to the input of membranes and cables, because if I input a membrane or a cable, the program have to calculate it according the theory third order for large deformations. And with this calculation type, the program changes the load attribution to increments, to 5 increments. This means he find at first, in the first step, a solution for the 5th part of the load, then he add the next part until he have 100% load applied to the model. And we have 5 increments, so he divides the load by 5 and bring it up one after the next. So now we get a design. The smile is red. He write not designable. This is not nice, but we have to check it in detail why. And we see, okay, we have our 8 COs, and we get maybe CO1 is no problem, but CO2 until 5 is a problem. 6 is also fine, but all have the same error message: torsion existing. And it seems that the torsion issue appears only for the circular hollow tube. So this is a problem because the Eurocode rules have not exactly defined what happens with buckling on circular hollow tubes if they have some torsional bending moment on it. And if this appears, he writes an error message. I would say, so long we working with closed cross sections, we can neglect this rule. But if you work with open cross sections like an HEB, then we have to consider it, and it's not allowed. But here it clearly seems that this torsion message only appears for these closed cross sections, but not for this HEB. The HEB is clean. Yeah. So we go to details, to stability, and say, okay, limit shear stress is not restricted. We allow 20% of the plastic resistance. And if we run the design again, we only have to design the members and not to calculate forces again because they're already here. And we get now a clear figure. We have overutilization, what is, it's not okay, but is a result. You see CO2, 3, 4 are a problem, but let's see where the issue is. And for this, I go into the graphics. Display maybe the results without diagrams, and it's multicolored. And let's see where the issue appears. And for this, maybe it's always good to check the members by cross section and go through everything. And you will see, okay, this upper chart have a utilization of 0.53, so it's fine. So, and again, this lower chart plus columns have this overutilization, and it's clear that only this in mid beam, these two cross sections are overloaded. And here I only would place the same circular hollow tube with a bigger material thickness, and I think you can solve it. But this would force me to recalculate everything. So this is maybe the result, and now we have to change the model a little bit. The AGBs are by 86, fine. The bracing by 73, also fine. Cable we not designed, and the round bracing members also by 70%. So the rest is fine, and we only need, we have to increase this column and lower chord members in the mid frame. So this was everything to the design to the members. And if you want to design the membranes, I recommend to use the module here limits. It's here. And in this module, it's possible to compare or to check existing force values with a manual resistance. And we know if you have to design membranes, you have to consider maybe the load durance of or the durance of loads and also the temperature. So we have here generally three situations: one permanent load case, one wind load case, and one snow load case, which gives us different design values for the membrane. And here, and this also corresponding some material tests, so the user-defined input is not bad here. For the permanent situation, maybe it's only in the CO1, we can define here a case membrane permanent and go here to limits parameters where we say here membrane. We want to check here, for example, a surface 1 to 8. And for this surface, we want to check maybe the axial force Nx, which should run here for this permanent state from 0 to 25. And for warp and for weft direction, we check the Ny force for 0 to 18 kilonewtons before and between. And if I run this two checks, I get, let's see what happens. We get here a green check. So the existing force is by 1, the maximum is by 18, so everything is fine. So we copy this case and check it for membrane wind. Here we have to change loading, so all load case with wind. Yes, and here we only change these resistances from 50 for the warp direction and 36 for the weft direction. Calculate. And here it's by, let's say, the biggest one is 37, so existing 18 to 50. Yeah, so it's your game to define the resistance and to check all surfaces with this definition. And the last one, let's say copy load case, maybe snow. membrane, snow. Okay. And here, yeah, we have to change load, of course. It's this CO2. And here we have values, maybe 32 to 23. And let's calculate it. And here we are by 53. So I would say the membrane is too good for this roof, so we can maybe change to another product. But my target was only to show you how you can compare different type of loads against different resistances for surfaces. And the same you can do also for maybe new case for the cable. It's not restricted to membranes. So if we have maybe a limit force for a cable, we can define here cable for member and maybe select it for this and for this member. And here we want to check if the program knows member and offers us only member results. And here we check the normal axis force from 0 to maybe 248 kilonewton is allowed for this cable what we defined, and calculate, and let's see, the most critical is here CO5 with a utilization of 48. So maybe we can also reduce the cable stiffness, but it should show you this limit gives you the possibility to do these checks and even to store all your data in a user-defined library so that you don't have to define all these values by model to model. And this brings me now to the end of my presentation, and I give back my control to Andreas.